This week at the Internet Cafe, portals. What's a portal anyway? Seems everyone on the net wants to be one, including Netscape. NetCenter's Mike Homer will tell us why giving away websites is a better business than giving away software. Excite is one of the big portals to be. It used to be a search engine. Now it wants to be a community. Justin Hall ran a portal before anyone ever heard of the word. Now he's got an alternative portal for people who, well, think like he does. This is City Search. Who said the internet has nothing to do with geography? City Search brings together people living in the same city to meet, have fun, and find out what's going on in town. Writer Larry Maggot says portals are all about business and money. He'll tell us why. And we'll take you to Hotbot, a search engine that still believes that a good search engine is a terrible thing to waste. Portals, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Net Cafe is made possible in part by CyberSmith, wired for fun and learning, with locations in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Palo Alto, California, and White Plains, New York. And by TechWeb, for up-to-the-minute technology news.
So we're talking about portals, and Andrew, I know in your other life you work with Hotwired and Hotbot, and you're sort of involved in this issue, so kind of give us a little bit of an education here. What really is a portal?
Well, I think a portal is probably more of a business term than a consumer term. Think of a window on a ship, right? basically, it's a place that people will come to first when they go onto the internet.
Right.
Hopefully, it's a place that catches a lot of traffic and keeps people coming back by providing different services. You know, kind of
like a Yahoo and NetCenter.
Yeah, kind of like what AOL was before the web took off.
Right.
AOL was your one-stop inclusive place.
And why does it matter? I mean, why do people want to be portals?
Well, it matters for business because the more you get people to come back and continue
traffic,
to come back,
ads,
the more
dollars,
traffic, the
money.
More they'll look at your advertising, and that's big bucks.
Big money.
What do you think about that? I mean, would you hang out in a portal or do that kind of thing, or is it?
No, I think the whole issue of portals is, you know, you have to have a sticky portal now, right? So you have to get them to
hold you in there. You can't get away.
Yeah,
right.
Like flies to fly paper. So that's the whole next step.
As Andrew says, it's a business. Well, we'll find out more tonight.
So, Joe, you're one of the co-founders of Excite, a website that is, I guess, according to the terminology of today, is considered to be a portal site.
The word of the day, portal.
Yeah, there it is. Community, portal, the whole nine yards. What, for those of us who are familiar with the concept of portal sites and who have seen the likes of Yahoo and AOL and Excite, how would you differentiate what Excite is doing compared to Yahoo, for example?
I'd really focus on two areas. Those areas are personalization and community. So personalization is the notion that you can make a web experience that's entirely your own, remembers you each time you come back, and you decide what that's going to look like. And then community, the notion of interacting with other people online.
Now, on the topic of personalization, the one thing that I find extremely frustrating with sites is that in order for me to personalize, I have to go through all of these screens, and it takes me lots of time to do that. So I'm not completely convinced that personalization is what I want. Why? Are you doing anything that makes it more palatable for me?
Well, one of the ways we differentiate ourselves in personalization is the fact that we do something called creeping personalization. I know, it sounds
creeping.
Bad.
Okay.
It sounds bad, but it's really, it makes it a lot easier.
Is this a geek term? This is creeping?
No,
oh, okay.
It's just a Joe term.
All right.
Well, creeping personalization is most sites require you to fill out this huge form. Before you even get to see what your personalized page looks like.
It drives me crazy.
It drives a lot of people crazy. And so what we did instead is we give you a default page, a page that has news, stocks, sports, weather, horoscope. May not be personalized to you, but it gives you a sense of what you're going to see. And then beyond that, in order to personalize, we don't require you to fill out a big form. Give us your zip code today, and we'll give you personalized weather, personalized sports scores. Give us your birthday the next day, we'll give you a personalized horoscope. So again, the notion is you can give just little bits of information at a time, go at your own pace, it makes it much easier to personalize.
So through experience, I can basically learn what it is. Well, I didn't like it this way, I might want to change it, I can tweak
it
over time.
Go at your own pace, see what you're going to get before you even have to give any information.
So now, portal sites, when I think about them, I think about chat rooms, I think about search engines, I think about free mail, maybe even personalized home pages. Are you doing all of those things? Are you focusing on a small number of those things?
Well, three of the four things you mentioned there are really around this notion of community,
mm-hmm.
which is about people using the internet to connect with one another online. And typically the word community means chat and email and bulletin boards and instant messaging. All things that we offer, all stuff that consumers love. We're trying to take it to the next level with a product that we actually call Excite Communities. And what that is chat is like a cocktail party of thousands, where it's great for meeting people, but it's not very good for having meaningful discussions. That's very unlike an intimate dinner party, where you can control who's coming to that dinner party and control the topic of conversation. Excite Communities is much more like the intimate dinner party.
Okay, so can you explain to me what
I'll take it a step further.
Walk me down the path.
Certainly. What Excite Communities is you and I could set up a community, and only you and I could get into that community. And once we're in that community, we could share a calendar. You could post where you're going on that calendar.
Oh,
I could
collaborate
post.
With somebody else.
Absolutely.
Okay, I've got
you can share an address book of relevant contacts for each of us. We can share photo albums. So it's great for families who are maybe spread across the country as a way to stay in touch. It's great for small businesses that maybe need to have multiple people in the office coordinate around a calendar or an address book. It's even great for events. If you're planning a wedding, one thing you could do is have the address book of hotels near where your event is going to be,
or a
calendar of all the events leading up to the wedding.
So when I think about a great portal site for personalization and community, Excite.com.
Absolutely.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com. Well, Charles, you have founded CitySearch.com, which is what?
City Search is where to go and what to do in your community. It helps people find more out about their city in areas like arts and entertainment, community, recreation, or shopping.
All right, so it's really kind of a collection of sites then, depending on what city you live in?
Actually, most of City Search has created original content by our own editorial team rather than a compilation of links.
All right, so say we're in the Bay Area right now,
yep.
And I want to find out what's going on. Is that why I would go to City Search, find out what's going on, what's there to do tonight, and restaurants? And
absolutely. City Search has 500 Italian restaurants online. We have every movie.
Just for San Francisco?
Absolutely.
All right.
Every bit of theater, recreation, including mountain biking, pretty much anything you might want to do out in the San Francisco area.
Now, we're sort of talking about portals in this show. Do you think of City Search as a portal, a kind of starting point where if I live in the Bay Area, I could go there and find out anything I needed through City Search?
Yeah, portal's a funny word. I think the City Search is a local portal. We help people organize their local experience. I think geography is the most important organizing principle for people's behavior, and that's what City Search is about.
Well, that's funny because we think of the net as anti-geography in a way.
Right.
The whole bit of the net is you can be talking to somebody across the street or around the world, and it's all the same thing. But you're saying, no, where you are physically really still matters even on the web.
People spend 95% of their time and their money within 10 or 15 miles of their homes. It's still the most relevant thing for them.
All right, now if I go on to City Search, let's say we're in San Francisco, what are the kinds of things I could find? Is it just the what's going on stuff, or is there more?
No, actually quite a bit more. It would include quite a bit of dense information on what's happening in your community. In some of our cities, we have school lunches. We have we have church sermons. We have sales and coupons, what's happening in the city, as well as recreation. So it's not just arts and entertainment. Really dense, what's happening in the city, but in a much broader sense than just A&E.
Now, I haven't noticed a lot of ads in City Search. I mean, what's the business model here?
Yeah, the business model is different from most internet companies. We sell sites to small and medium-sized businesses, full interactive sites, and then we host them in this high-traffic environment.
All right, so your content is coming primarily from partners in each of these cities, is that the deal?
Our content comes from partners in some cities.
We're newspapers, TV stations?
Yeah, we're partnered with the LA Times in LA or Washington Post in Washington. In other cities, we own and operate the city ourselves, and the content comes from our own editorial team.
All right, and how many cities does City Search cover at the moment?
We're in 18 cities that are either up or underway, and those include cities in Europe, in Scandinavia, in Canada, as well as the South Pacific.
How big does a city have to be to economically get it to be a City Search city? I take it you're not going to get below the top 25 or something?
Actually, we think we can get smaller than that, although we don't really know for sure. Today, the smallest City Search city is about 750,000 people. There are many attractive cities that are as small as 350 or 500,000 now.
They've got some competition out there, other people sort of doing similar things. What's distinctive about City Search?
City Search is genuinely created locally. It's not a hodgepodge of links to other people's sites. It's created by local editors designed for this medium in the city, involving local people and including local media companies. Most of the other folks actually try and create their sites from some central location.
Is there a sort of community building aspect also to City Search? Is there chat? Are there classifieds and stuff like that?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, there's a lot of community in City Search. We have, in San Francisco alone, 1,200 community partners who put up their calendar of events or their newsletter, pretty much anything that's happening in those local community groups.
There, the geography really does make a lot of sense.
Right.
You want to talk to people you can really deal with, not somebody in Europe somewhere.
From the Omega Boys Club to the Easter Seals.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
David, Hotbot is a great search engine. It's won lots of awards, PC World, one example of it. What is it about Hotbot that's made it so popular in the last year or so?
The focus of what we do at Hotbot is to focus on the idea of providing a better and better search service for people. And that's been our focus since launch. We concentrate on providing people with the most comprehensive database of the web. That means providing people with an index of as many web pages as we can. We provide an index of about 110 million web pages, whereas other search engines index smaller slices of the web. But more than that, we focus on the detail that we index of those web pages. What that means that we can do is allow people to refine their search much more accurately. For instance, if you were looking for information on iMac, you could start by searching on iMac, but if you wanted recent information, you could, for instance, say, I only want web pages that were updated in the past 21 days. You can easily do that on Hotbot using pull-down menus, so you don't need to know complex Boolean constructions to construct that sort of query.
Right, because I think that's one of the big things about search engines, at least for me, is that I get a lot of I type something in, I may not use the query appropriately or use the right language, and then when I do, I get all of this irrelevant stuff. So you're saying that a lot of the features that you have allow me to be much more precise on my searching?
That's what we're trying to do, is to find more and more ways in which we allow the user to, who's starting off with 110 million web pages, that's a lot of web pages,
right.
And they need to find the sort of the two or three out of that 110 million, the two or three that suit their needs. And so, for instance, if you were interested in knowing what people in Africa are saying about iMac, on Hotbot, in the advanced search page, you can easily, using a pull-down menu, search suggest websites in Africa.
Okay.
And so the combination of those features, the fact that we know a lot of information about those pages and that we index all of those pages, allows us to help users to quickly hone in on what they do.
So it seems it's a combination of the amount of information that you're retrieving and then the way in which you're searching. So
the detail.
So now Hotbot is really focused as a search engine, but
right.
The topic is portal sites. Would you define Hotbot as a portal site or just a search engine?
Hotbot is what one might describe as a navigation portal.
Okay.
We have some 8 million or so unique users that come to Hotbot in any given month. And the focus of the service that we're providing to those people is navigation, allowing them to find their way around the web. That's at the core of what we do. We do provide other services for people, like we provide free email for people. We also allow people to construct their own homepages and things like that. But the focus of what we're doing is to provide users with a richer and richer search experience.
So if you would compare Yahoo, Excite, Lycos, and all of these other portal sites, and you'd say, okay, well, how does Hotbot compare? It's the focus on the search engine. Is that?
That's what really sets us apart, both in our minds, so that informs our strategy as a company, but also, I think, in the minds of users. And when the people that use Hotbot say that they really appreciate that we continue to focus on providing people with the best search engine. We've got an interface that really focuses around the idea of helping people navigate their way around the web, providing what are sometimes complex search tools, but in an interface that's very easy to use. So the beginners on the web like to use Hotbot because they can use these pull-down menus and point-and-click interfaces. The advanced users, people who are themselves building websites, like to use this because we provide an array of tools that allow them to quickly find the information that they're looking for.
So the ultimate navigation portal.
Yes.
Hotbot. Thanks so much, David.
All right, Larry Maggid's back with us here at CyberSmith, and we're talking about portals, Larry, and a couple questions I'd want to ask you. From a user's point of view, number one, if I'm using Netscape, the defaults, I end up in NetCenter. Do I lose something as a user by just staying there, or should I go off to the Yahoos or someplace else?
Well, it's not that you lose anything. It's just that you're sort of corralled into Netscape's definition of
right.
what they want you to see. And, these portals are controlled by business relationships. I hate to break it to the world, but it's no accident that one particular computer network or one particular news service is on there. And so what you're really losing is the variety or the myriad of material that's out on the web.
So don't be necessarily content with just using that default.
Right. I would not only go to other portals, but I would also seek out sites directly. Seek out the really interesting news sites.
Get in there and type your WWs.
Absolutely, and do the searches. The portals at least will take you to interesting places.
Last point, you mentioned the business aspect of this, and it concerns me a bit, and some of us who remember the populist days of the web, are we televisionizing the web now? We're going to see five or six networks called portals and big corporate control over what we do on the web?
Well, in a sense we are, in a sense we're not. In a sense we're televisionizing and saying that the popular sites are going to be few and far between.
Yeah.
But there are still going to be thousands, in fact, millions of websites out there, and there are not millions of television stations.
Yeah.
Choice is there, but you have to seek it out now.
Larry, thank you.
My pleasure.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
Justin Hall, you are somewhat of a visionary, at least I think with the in crowd of the web.
Oh, wow.
And I'm going to give you that title anyway.
Woo-hoo.
And you created, I think, one of the first, we could say it was a portal site kind of back in the web's beginning, Links to the Underground, or Links from the Underground.
Okay. Yeah, that was January 1994, and what it was for me was I was just surfing a lot. And when I was surfing, I was coming across all this stuff, and I didn't know if other people were seeing it. So it was kind of a one-man portal in 1994. It was
so
kind
of a list, basically, of links
that
you
liked. There was value add. There was content going on because I would commentate on the links, and you would find that there was a niche being. So it wasn't kind of a dry list of everything that was out there. It wasn't. It had a slant to it, and it had a guiding function provided.
Okay.
In that, if your tastes correlated with mine, you would find
that
satisfying
kind of
results. Yeah.
And that was one of the first sites, by my recollection, to do something like that. And obviously, other folks have come in and around the same time, and
sure.
And now they're big business,
yeah.
and portals and all this crazy terms going on.
Well, I don't know if I was a portal, because one of the things that I think is really exciting about the portals today is that they really do strive to match you up with other people.
Mm-hmm.
A study came out from Carnegie Mellon University today saying that web surfing and internet time on the internet is a depressing activity. Like,
you know, I saw that.
That's right. If you do that, you'll end up just a little bit more depressed than you were before you got on. And so I think what people are trying to do to remedy this is to hook people up. Instant messaging, email,
mm-hmm.
all this stuff, get people online, personal web pages. And for me, what was the problem with links.net, Links from the Underground, was that it was a solo activity. I was doing all this, but people would write in, and I had nowhere to put their stuff, and I knew that all these people were buzzing around it, but there was no way for them to kind of get together and talk about what was going on. And so,
okay, now I get a sense you're leading into your new site here.
That's right.
Okay.
Which is more permeable, which is what's exciting, because it's just a structure, and a lot of other people have built what's actually, the walls. If it's a building, I put up the framework, everybody else did the stuff that's inside of it.
So let's start with the name,
bud.com.
What does bud.com mean?
It's extremely short, memorable, friendly, right? I mean, it has a multitude of meanings, so it's a kind of common word in a different community.
And
it means different
things. Lawsuits from Anheuser-Busch for that
No,
one.
They offered me money for it a couple years ago, and I said I wasn't interested just because it was on all my business cards and stuff.
Smart move, I think.
It's short, and it's got some personality to it, but it's also like a young plant,
okay.
Right? If you want to take it at this point,
okay.
That's what bud.com is right now. Yeah.
Now tell me though, you say you've got a community aspect to it. What are you doing that is maybe bringing people together now that the other site didn't do?
Well, I think if you look at the front page of bud.com, you see that you don't even know who put it together. If to know that I put it together, you'd have to go to my other webpage. So it's an open structure. It's not branded. It's got
mm-hmm.
not got a name other than its own entity. And when you go to that entity, you're seeing names of all the people who've sent in the stuff that comprises
okay.
bud.com. So there's links out to the web, there's original pieces of writing, there's poems and stories and pieces of music that people have put together, and all that stuff, it has the name of the creators on it.
So
prominently.
It's an original piece of work, I guess.
Yeah, well,
say.
Or it's their take on something that is someone else's original piece of work. But it's their, everybody's putting their stamp on things and kind of giving you their perspective. And what's great is that each link, right, is two links, because you get the thing that they're talking about that's out on the web, that's part of internet culture, and you get their link to their personal web page. So you get the mingling of personal perspective, the people who are putting in stuff, the other readers, and you're getting whatever it is that they're talking about.
So it sounds like you've created the alternate portal, if you will. So we'll have to go check it out.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com. All right, Mike, you are a vice president at Netscape, and you're the manager of NetCenter, as I understand it, which is Netscape's move into the portal business, right? I mean, we're talking about portals. Is this what you're trying to do with NetCenter?
Yes, that's right. Build out our entire set of services on the website so that the portal site, NetCenter, can be a one-stop shop for all of Netscape
users.
You've
got this huge advantage because a lot of people using Netscape browser, it defaults to Netscape, which is now NetCenter. Give us a little bit of the strategy behind this evolution. I mean, Netscape sort of was a software company and then a browser company, and now you're really in the content business on the web?
Yeah, we started out, as you know, really selling the browser primarily
right.
in 95 and then expanded the product line to include servers and then enterprise software
right.
in 96 and 97. All along that time, we were improving the services we offered on the site. So back in 95, we started selling our first ads, and we brought live our general store, mm-hmm. and we started our search program. And we added individual services throughout the whole period from 95 to the middle of 97. What we did in the middle of 97 is we expanded that into a set of services that was a lot broader under a single sign-up so that we could essentially begin collecting members of NetCenter and then add to the whole service.
All right, now when you collect these members at NetCenter, I take it it's to make money in some way, right? I mean, what's the business model here?
It's twofold. I mean, on the one hand, if we're able to get somebody to sign up for NetCenter, then they become a member, we know a little bit about them, and then we're able to offer them more tailored services. So the user services are better. On the other hand, of course, the more people that come and the more frequently they use the site, the more advertising opportunity there is.
Sure.
And if those happen to be people that are members, then we know enough about them to present custom advertising to them and things like that.
Right. So, I mean, you're trying to become, I mean, a Yahoo in a way. Is that the model here? I mean, they've been very successful with this.
Yeah. I mean, we have, you know, enjoyed a lot of revenue from our website for a long time.
Right.
In fact, we did $105 million of revenue last year, and Yahoo did $69 million. That's a little
now,
known aspect.
Is that
aspect.
Ad revenue?
It is about 80% ad revenue.
And the other is what?
The other is selling software on the site and
okay.
other types of promotional services. So we actually have had this very, very lucrative and successful business in selling ads and building revenues on NetCenter. What we hadn't done is built as good a service for the end user, and we hadn't really focused on that business primarily because we were still making our money from software.
Now, a lot of the stuff when you go there, you go to some content and click on NetCenter, and it says buy Excite. Are you really kind of, is it the same thing as going to Excite if I go through NetCenter?
No, it's not. We have a series of services that are things like smart browsing and search and free webmail that we have on our site that we have done in an integrated package for the user. In addition to that, we have worked with Excite to build out about half of the content channels that are on NetCenter. Mm-hmm. And the ones that you see, where you see the Excite co-branding, are the ones that we work on along with them. You still will be in NetCenter. You still will be using our personalization and all the advantages of the client integration. But they're providing content on half of the channels.
Mike, there's a little bit of AOL I see in here, too. You've got these pop-up ads that sort of blast at you whether you want them or not. You've got sort of ads hidden everywhere. You click on a thing, you think it's text, but it turns out being an ad. Is that sort of a necessary part of the way this has to work?
Yeah, I think that what we've learned through a lot of research over the last 3.5 years on the site is that way beyond banner ads, people actually like to have their promotion be more targeted.
Yeah.
Pop-ups are a great example. We found that if we put up a pop-up in front of people and it's for a discount on, you know, CDs or in books, then the rate with which people will complain is, you know, maybe 2 or 3%, right? However, if we offer somebody a software upgrade that's targeted to them because they have 3.0 and they want to go to 4.0, then we might get a tenth of that rate.
Yeah.
In any case, most people actually don't mind the ads if they get the whole service for free.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the trade. We make our money on some of the ads, and we offer free services to the
user.
All
right. NetCenter, thanks a lot, Mike. So we got to see a couple of portals and talk to some folks, and I think you were right in the first place, right? It's really a business thing. It's a way to grab people and hold on to them and sell them to advertisers.
Well, the real challenge for all of these portals is to actually create value that people want to actually come back to. I think some are doing it and some aren't. I think all of them really want to create a community. And we looked at this guy, Justin Hall.
A little different.
Yeah, Links from the Underground. Well, he created sort of, you know, one of the first community feelings.
A very personal community.
Right. People would come back to his site over and over again. That's what all the big companies want now, too. Get you to keep coming back.
Yeah.
Sticky.
Yeah, she said sticky. But now, what about you? Is this sort of too restraining for you to say, no, I'm always going to go in through NetCenter or whatever?
Well, I'm not one for sort of doing the same thing over and over again. The other thing is that it's kind of one-upmanship. There's always something new that somebody else is adding.
So,
I don't know. I think if you do a few things really, really well, then I'm going to keep coming back to you for those few things that you do really well. I'm not really a big believer that there's only going to be one or two places that everybody always
goes. Well, CitySearch, the guy I talked to, was one good example where they focus on people in one town, and that's kind of useful rather than the general ones. Anyhow, portals, we'll check a couple of them out. That's it for Internet Cafe. We'll see you here next time.
The Net Cafe is made possible in part by CyberSmith, wired for fun and learning, with locations in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Palo Alto, California, and White Plains, New York. And by TechWeb, for up-to-the-minute technology news. To purchase a videotaped copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.